Thank the organizers for allowing me to come and talk a little bit about research. Can you all hear me in the back of the room?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. It's really an honor to come and talk in front of you. What I will do to begin is tell you a little bit about what's going on at the University of Pittsburgh and our medical center in terms of Parkinson's disease. We have a Center for Advanced Research, as Leslie mentioned, which is funded through the APDA. It was established about 10 years ago, and there's a strong and growing clinical movement disorders group, including neurologists, physician assistants, neurosurgeons, physical therapists, and so on. Several of the doctors are listed as best doctors in America. The medical center where we're located is one of the 10 best in the country, according to U.S. News and World Report. And neurology there ranks similarly. We have a great group of laboratory investigators, and as Leslie mentioned, we have something called the Pittsburgh Institute for Neurodegenerative Diseases. I'm the director of that institute, and one of my patients dubbed me the pinhead for being the head of this thing. What I'd like to do is talk a little bit about causes of Parkinson's disease and tell you about a model that we've developed that helps to lead us to better understanding of what causes the disease and how we might intervene therapeutically, how we can block some of the steps that lead nerve cells to die. A little about the epidemiology of the disease. You all probably know that men are at a higher risk than women. Age is a big risk factor for developing the disease. If you have an affected family member, your risk of developing the disease is a bit higher. There are things that reduce your risk. So if you've been a caffeine consumer, coffee, tea, you generally have a lower risk. Not that it necessarily helps you once you have the disease, but it lowers your risk of developing the disease in the first place. Smoking has been associated with a lower risk of the disease for unclear reasons. If you've used a class of drugs that includes ibuprofen or Aleve or those kinds of drugs on a regular basis, you have a slightly lower risk. And if you've been an exerciser, somebody who's physically fit and maintains an exercise program, you have a lower risk. Not that these things are completely protective, but they lower your overall risk. And then there are certain environmental risk factors for developing the disease. If you've been exposed to pesticides over the course of your life, particularly if you do this as an occupation or you're a farmer and you mix and apply your own pesticides, you have an increased risk. By the same token, farming increases your risk. Drinking well water in rural areas, and this may be related to the pesticides again, is associated with an increased risk. And for some reason, it's not clear, teachers, physicians, clergy all have a slightly higher risk of developing the disease, and there's some thought that this may relate to exposures to infectious agents, but it's not really clear. There have been a lot of environmental toxins that have been used to try and model the disease in animals, and one of the first of these was a toxin called MPTP, which drug users, heroin users, accidentally injected, and it made them sort of immediately, severely, and permanently Parkinsonian. The drug that they injected turns out that it poisons the power plants within cells, the so-called mitochondria, and it led to us being able to use this toxin to give it to mice or to rats or even to monkeys and be able to have a very good model for developing new drugs for the disease. Another toxin that's been used frequently in modeling Parkinson's disease is something called paraquat, which is used in agriculture to get rid of weeds. And it causes oxidative stress, kind of, you've heard of free radicals and that kind of thing. It causes free radicals and damages your cells, and it causes Parkinson's disease-like symptoms in mice, And it turns out that if you are exposed to paraquat, you have an increased risk of developing Parkinson's disease yourself. And then what I'm going to focus on in more detail is a compound called rotenone. And as I'll tell you and show you, rotenone is a pesticide that was commonly used up until probably about 10 years ago when we started publishing data that it wasn't so safe. It's the powder that we all used to sprinkle if we had a tomato garden, those puffers that we used that we all thought were safe. That was rotenone, which can cause Parkinson's disease in rats, in monkeys, and it turns out in humans as well. So a little bit more about rotenone. It inhibits an enzyme in your cellular power plants called the mitochondria. The enzyme is called complex 1. And it, as a result, causes formation of free radicals, so oxidative damage. And it reduces the power that these mitochondria make, so you don't get enough energy in your cells. And the cells become sick and can eventually die. What's interesting about rotenone is that it's a natural compound. It comes from roots and leaves of a variety of plants. And we tend to think about natural things as being safe. In fact, the rotenone was used in the organic gardening industry because it was assumed because it's natural, it must be safe. But it's not. And it's still used in lakes and reservoirs if you want to get rid of nuisance fish or sample fish populations. So these are some of the products that contained rotenone until recently. And it's still used in a number of countries, and as I said, it's still used in our lakes and reservoirs to kill nuisance fish. So what does rotenone do? Well, rotenone causes neurodegeneration, and to make sure that we're all sort of on the same page, what I have here is a picture of human brain sort of cut in this plane. So it's a slice like this through our brain. And let's see if I can. Can you see the pointer moving around? No? Okay, let's try again. Is there a pointer moving around?
No.
No? Okay, well, I guess I have no way to sort of show you. In red is the dopamine neuron, and it begins way down low in your brain in a region called the substantia nigra. And it sends its terminals up forward in the brain to areas of the brain called the caudate and putamen. And that's sort of the business end of the neurons. And that's where the degeneration begins. That's where your dopamine is having its effect on your motor function. And those red neurons there, the red cells that I've diagrammed, are what degenerate most prominently in the disease. So in this picture, we have staining for the dopamine nerve terminals in a normal brain on the left. And on the right, you see what happens in Parkinson's disease. All the dopamine is lost there. Now, another way to look at that, that some of you have heard about, is with things like DAT scans. So on the left here, you can see an image of the dopamine nerve terminals in a normal human brain. In the middle panel, you see someone with relatively early mild Parkinson's disease, and you can see the clear loss of the dopamine there. And on the right, you see more severe Parkinson's disease. So let me get back to the rotenone model now. If we give rotenone to rats chronically over a period of weeks, they develop something that looks just like the human disease. So what we have standing across the top row is the dopamine nerve terminals where they would degenerate in Parkinson's disease. And you can see starting in panel B and moving to the right, that there's a loss of those nerve terminals when the animals are exposed to this pesticide. Eventually, this causes death of the neurons that are in the substantia nigra, so the cells are gone, and you just can't regenerate them at this point. Now, one of the important things that I'll point out here is that rotenone, if you look at these pictures, is causing degeneration on both sides of the brain simultaneously and symmetrically. And that will be important when I talk about some therapies that we're testing in this model. One of the other things that is characteristic of Parkinson's disease, and I think you've all probably heard of this, is the Lewy body. And this is what a Lewy body looks like in a dopamine neuron. These yellow globs that you see, those are what we call inclusions within the cell. They contain a number of proteins, including a protein that I'll talk about called alpha-synuclein, which plays a big role in the disease. These were never seen in a rat until we had given a rat rotenone. So we have the first model that is reproducing the Lewy bodies that all Parkinson's patients have in their brains. Now we can make them in a rat brain by giving them a pesticide called rotenone. If you look at them by electron microscopy, they look just like a real human Lewy body. It turns out that the rotenone model that we have developed in rats reproduces a lot of the features of Parkinson's disease, and I won't go through this list, I don't have time. But I'll point out that if we give the rats rotenone, we even get gastrointestinal symptoms. The rats become constipated, their GI system doesn't work well, just as what happens in Parkinson's disease. Now, all this work in the rats led investigators to try to figure out whether rotenone was really a risk factor for human disease. And some work by Carly Tanner and some of her colleagues out in California looked at a large number of farmers and pesticide applicators and their spouses, and found that if you're exposed to rotenone, you have a 2 to 3-fold increased risk of developing Parkinson's disease. So it's a real risk factor. They really developed from our work in the rats. So environment plays a big role in developing Parkinson's disease, but it turns out genes do too. In some cases, Parkinson's disease is hereditary. I'm sure there are some of you who have multiple affected people in the family. And this is a list, it's an out-of-date list, of some of the genes that have been discovered that cause Parkinson's disease. And I don't expect you to be able to read this or to see all of this, but just to point out that there are a lot of different genes that can cause the disease. Most of the time, in typical Parkinson's disease, it's not genetic. About 90% of the time, it is not genetic, but about 10% of the time it is. And it turns out some of these genes play a role, even if the disease is not hereditary in your family, it's not running in your family. Some of these genes are very important. And one of the genes that comes up over and over again is a protein called alpha-synuclein. Alpha-synuclein, we don't know what it really does normally in the brain, but when we develop Parkinson's disease, it forms those Lewy bodies, those big globs of protein that I showed you in the cells. So it's playing some very important role. And a number of investigators around the world think that if we could reduce the levels of alpha-synuclein somehow, we might be able to treat the disease or slow it down. And that's what I want to focus on for the next few minutes, a new strategy for treating Parkinson's disease. And that strategy that I'll tell you about is gene therapy. And I'm sure you've all heard of gene therapy. Let me try and explain it in a bit more detail. Gene therapy can have a lot of different purposes depending on what's causing the disease. If the mutation is causing a loss of function in the cell, gene therapy might be able to replace that function and restore it. If a protein is somehow, when it's mutated, causing toxicity, if we can silence that gene, then we may reduce its toxicity and protect the cells. if there's something going on, such as oxidative stress, we might be able to put in a protein that reduces oxidative stress and protect the cells. Or we may be able to turn a cell that is overactive in Parkinson's disease and causing some of their symptoms, we might be able to change its physiological properties and make it less active and reduce the symptoms. So there's lots of different things that gene therapy might be used for. And what I'll focus on is this idea that alpha-synuclein is causing toxicity in the cells, causing these Lewy bodies. And if we can reduce alpha-synuclein, maybe we can protect the cells. So that's the starting point. And you'll recall that alpha-synuclein is causing these Lewy bodies as shown here. So we're going to try and manipulate the DNA, the genes that are making alpha-synuclein. And I thought this was a kind of a neat slide, sort of showing in cartoon fashion what we hope to do. Of course, we can't see DNA. We can manipulate it chemically, but it's not big like this. We can't pick it up and manipulate it. Now, how do we deliver the DNA to the brain? Well, we would like to do it by putting DNA in a capsule or a tablet, but we can't. It doesn't get into the brain. There's no way to get it to cross the so-called blood-brain barrier and to specifically target the neurons that are sick. So instead of packaging the DNA into a capsule, what we have to do is put it into a virus. In this case, it's a virus called adeno-associated virus, or AAV. So you have the virus that contains the genes that you want to put into the brain. Then what you have to do is actually inject it into the brain. So in a mouse or a rat, we do this in the laboratory, and I'll show you experiments in this regard. In humans, it's done through neurosurgery. This is a picture of a neurosurgeon friend of mine named Mike Caplet at Cornell University doing gene therapy at that institution. So the surgery is much like DBS. In rats, what we've done is inject a virus to try and silence alpha-synuclein on one side of the brain. And what we hope is that we can prevent the degeneration on that side of the brain compared to the uninjected side of the brain, and see if this approach has utility. So you'll recall again that the rote node is causing symmetrical degeneration in the striatum on both sides of the brain. So what we did was inject the virus and the gene therapy on one side of the brain, administer rote node to the animals for a few weeks, and see whether the side that got the gene therapy was protected. And in fact, it is. So if you look at the panel A there in green, you see the nerve terminals, and on the left side of the brain, you see the hole where the nerve terminals, the dopamine cells, have died. And on the side that got the gene therapy, on the right, you see preservation of those nerve terminals. And we've done this now in tens of animals, and the side that gets the gene therapy is always protected. We not only protect the nerve terminals, which are sort of the business end of the nerves, but we protect the cell bodies back in the substantia nigra. So if you look on the right, on the top row there, hopefully you can see lots of little green dots. Those are the dopamine neurons on the protected side of the brain that got gene therapy. And on the left is the side that didn't get a gene therapy, and you can see that there's a loss of those neurons. The animals are also protected behaviorally. So one of the tests that we use in rats is to look at their postural stability. It's essentially looking at their balance. It's the equivalent of many of you have gone to the neurologist and had them tug on you and see how quickly you can recover and not fall down. So-called postural stability testing. This is what we do in the rats with a specialized test. And as we give rotenone, if you look, for example, on the left-hand graph, and we're measuring their right paw and the left paw in the bars that are white and black, you see that with increasing days of getting rotenone, their posterous instability gets worse, the bars get higher. But if you look at the graph on the right, the side that got the gene therapy in white doesn't change, despite the fact that they're continuing to get rotenone. So the uninjected side is getting worse, and the injected side is protected behaviorally. Another way to look at the data is to look at the percent of rescue of their behavior, and you see virtually complete protection of the behavior by the gene therapy. So we're very encouraged that this is a strategy that we can use and translate into the clinic. This virus, the AAV2 virus that we used in the rats, has been used successfully for other purposes in humans, so we know it's safe, and we hope to translate this into some clinical trials. Now I'm going to tell you next about a clinical trial gene therapy that we expect to begin this fall. This is a slide I showed you earlier in which it shows the progressive loss of dopamine in a PET scan. And you'll recall that the degeneration begins at the nerve terminals, which are imaged in these slides. Now, I show this slide again to tell you that these red neurons that I've diagrammed here are the dopamine neurons. Those are the ones that make dopamine and release dopamine, and they're the ones that degenerate in Parkinson's disease. In green are the neurons they communicate with, the neurons in the striatum or the caudate and putamen, as they're sometimes called. Those remain intact as Parkinson's disease progresses, but the red ones go away. So I'm going to blow up that area. And in this slide, sort of on the left, is one of the dopamine nerve terminals, and it's diagrammed that you can see the L-DOPA in green, and it gets converted into dopamine by an enzyme called DOPA decarboxylase. And that enzyme is essential for making the dopamine that ultimately gets released. And it acts through chemical transmission. The dopamine gets released and interacts with the cells that are right next to it. And that's how you get normal movement. What happens in Parkinson's disease, however, is that this enzyme, the DOPA decarboxylase, is lost as these nerve terminals slowly degenerate. And what that leads to is when we get levodopa, so many of you are taking levodopa, the levodopa is converted inefficiently and somewhat erratically to dopamine. Early in the disease, this isn't too much of a problem. Later in the disease, it leads to motor fluctuations, turning off unexpectedly. It leads to dyskinesias with uncontrolled movements. And it leads to generally a poor quality of life. So what can we do about that? One option is to do gene therapy and take that enzyme that gets lost, the DOPA decarboxylase, and put it in the cells that don't degenerate in Parkinson's disease. And if we do that, then the levodopa that we get administered gets converted into dopamine, and we can get normal function. And the advantage of this is that even as the dopamine cells in your brain slowly degenerate, you still have deep dopa-decarboxylase in the brain, this, in cells that's not, that are not degenerating. So it's there, it should smooth the response and reduce the amount of levodopa that you take and make therapy much more effective. So this is some work from Dr. Chris Bankowitz at the University of California, San Francisco. And what we see again are these PET scans of people with Parkinson's disease. And in the top row are five patients before they had the gene therapy. In the bottom row are patients 6 months after they had the gene therapy. And unfortunately, I don't have a pointer or a way to be able to show you, but each of these patients has an improvement in the dopamine levels in their brain from the gene therapy. It's more obvious in some than others. What this translates into is that they're all doing better functionally. So when we examine you in the clinic, we use a number of scales, looking at your rigidity, your speed of movement, your ability to walk, those kinds of things. And we score those in a system called the Unified Parkinson's Disease Rating Scale, or UPDRS. The higher the score, the worse you're doing. And you can see that at baseline compared to 6 months, virtually all of these patients are doing better after the gene therapy. Here's another set of patients done later, and you see the same trends. The scores get better with the gene therapy. Another way to look at it is how much time they're in the off state. And you can see that the off state is decreased, and the on time without dyskinesias is improved. So we're very encouraged about this. It looks very safe. To this point, only a small group of patients have been done at the University of California, San Francisco, and beginning this fall, we hope to begin recruitment at the University of Pittsburgh to join with UCSF to begin gene therapy trials. I'm going to finish up by talking about biomarkers in Parkinson's disease. And the story began with a specific kind of genetic form of Parkinson's disease, which were mutations in a gene called LRRK2. LRRK2 is the most common form of genetic Parkinson's disease, and lots of different mutations have been described. It's very common in certain ethnicities, so Ashkenazi Jews have a very high incidence of this mutation. North African Arabs have a very high incidence, but it's generally very common around the world. One of the problems is that we don't have a good way of figuring out what this gene does or how to attack Parkinson's disease that's caused by this mutation. What we would like is something called a biomarker. Now, biomarkers, you may have heard the word, and we mean lots of different things when we talk about biomarkers. They could be a biomarker for diagnosis, a blood test, or a scan, or some other test that would give us a diagnosis or tell us that you were going to develop Parkinson's long before you did. It could be something that tells us about the disease progression. It could be something that tells us that our drug is working, even before you notice changes in your symptoms. But so far, we don't have any good biomarkers for Parkinson's disease. And the work that I'm going to tell you about was done by a very talented young researcher in the laboratory named Lori Sanders. And she has been not only a fantastic researcher, she has worked with PAN, and you'll hear more from Roger about PAN this afternoon. She got the Parkinson's Action Network Postdoctoral Advocacy Award for all of her advocacy work on Capitol Hill. She's an enthusiastic champion of Parkinson's and its patients. So Lori began a collaboration with a researcher named Ulla Isaacson at Harvard, And what happened was Ulla had cells from patients who had this form of Parkinson's disease caused by LRRK2 mutations. He took skin samples from those patients and made them into stem cells. These are called induced pluripotent stem cells. So they don't come from a fetus, they come from your skin cells. And you can turn them into nerve cells in a dish. And he did that, and then he sent us these samples blinded because we wanted to look at a particular kind of damage to these cells in the cellular power plants called mitochondria. Now, the mitochondria, this is a picture of a nerve cell. Those little green things that you see in the cell there, they're kind of wrinkly, are the mitochondria. They produce the energy within all of our cells, and they're particularly critical in nerve cells in the brain. It turns out that mitochondria have their own DNA. We think of most of the DNA in a normal cell as being in the nucleus where our chromosomes are located, but mitochondria have their own DNA, and when it's damaged, it causes problems. So we wanted to look at mitochondrial DNA damage, and we took these cells that were sent to us from Ulla Isaacson at Harvard and assayed them. And this is what we found. So if you just look at the left-hand graph, and look at the bars in white. You basically don't see the bars in white. They're labeled C1, C2, and C3. That's the amount of damage in the controls, the people who don't have the LRRK2 mutations. And in the black and in the gray are the people who do have the LRRK2 mutations, and you can see there's much more damage in those cells. So everybody that we have tested who has a LRRK2 mutation has this mitochondrial DNA damage. They have the damage whether or not they have the disease. So you can carry the mutation for many years before you actually get the disease. And even if you have the mutation but don't have the disease yet, you have this mitochondrial DNA damage. And we can say with certainty that the mutation is causing the DNA damage, because if we collaborate with people who can go in and do what's called gene editing or gene correction, where we change the mutant form of LRRK2 to a normal form that's not mutated, the DNA damage goes away. So this is the first hint that we have a good biomarker for this form of Parkinson's disease. But what about typical Parkinson's disease? Typical Parkinson's is not genetic, it's not caused by LRRK2. We typically call it idiopathic or sporadic Parkinson's disease. And for this, we developed a different technique to look at mitochondrial DNA damage in actual brain tissue. And I won't go through the chemistry in that last slide. But what this allowed us to do was actually look at the damage and visualize it in the brains of people with Parkinson's disease. So if you look at the top row there, we have a section of the brain from somebody who doesn't have Parkinson's disease. And the dopamine cells are labeled in blue. I don't know if you can see blue on the projector or not. But you'll notice in the third panel in, third panel to the right, it's black and you don't see anything. And if you look in the bottom row, in the third panel in, you see lots of green staining. That's the DNA damage that we see in Parkinson's disease. And it turns out that all of the dopamine neurons in Parkinson's disease develop this mitochondrial DNA damage. Now, having found that DNA damage in neurons and in LRRK2 mutation carriers and so on, there are a number of questions that need to be asked. Can we detect this in peripheral tissues, like a blood sample or a skin sample from Parkinson's patients? Could we use this as a way to either diagnose or to follow treatment in Parkinson's disease? And could it be detected after environmental exposures to things like road manure? So for this purpose, we began a collaboration with a group in California that does work on environmental causes of Parkinson's disease, Carly Turner and Sam Goldman. And we looked at samples of DNA from healthy controls who had no exposures and did not have Parkinson's disease. And we looked at DNA samples from, and these are obtained from blood, from people who got exposed to things that increase your chances of getting Parkinson's disease, whether or not they had Parkinson's disease. And we looked at people with Parkinson's disease, whether or not they had exposure. So there were lots of different groups that we looked at. And this is what we found. So it's a little bit complicated. But if you look at on the left in the white circles, those are the healthy controls. So these are people without Parkinson's disease and without exposures to things that cause Parkinson's disease. If you look at the next group, marked PD, those are all of the Parkinson's patients, and they all had DNA damage, mitochondrial DNA damage. What's maybe the most interesting group is the group on the far right. It says TCE/PERC without PD. Those are people who got exposed to certain chemicals that we know increase your risk of developing Parkinson's disease, but they don't yet have Parkinson's disease. Yet they show the mitochondrial DNA damage. And we think that this is putting them at very high risk for subsequent development of Parkinson's. And so we're studying this group with great interest. We want to follow them to see if indeed this is a marker that they're going to develop the Parkinson's disease. And for this purpose, we got a grant from the National Institute on Environmental Health Sciences to follow this group. Finally, I'll just show you that Lori has replicated these findings in a completely different set of patients in Pittsburgh. These are just healthy controls and Parkinson's patients of all types. And you can see that there's the mitochondrial DNA damage in the Parkinson's patients compared to the controls. So we think that this is a way to monitor the disease potentially to see if we can reverse this with neuroprotective treatments and have that result in an improvement or a slowing of the disease. So I'll stop there with pictures of our clinicians and scientists working on Parkinson's at the University of Pittsburgh, and be happy to answer any questions. Thanks. AAV has been used for other gene therapies. So AAV is essentially is the virus, but it's sort of, you can think of it as the container that contains the gene. So other genes were put in to for example, change the physiological properties of certain neurons in the brain. And that looked moderately successful, but that trial, that the company that was leading that trial went out of business. It's been used for other genes that have been unsuccessful, but as a way to get the genes into the brain, it's safe and effective. Yes, you have to go in and specifically target. When you're doing gene therapy, so those who didn't hear the question, do you have to go to a specific part of the brain like DBS? And the answer is yes. So if you want to protect the dopamine neurons, you have to inject into the dopamine neuron region. If you want to change the firing patterns like DBS does, you have to go into the subthalamic nucleus, which is typically where the DBS electrodes go. Um, You have to go for the most affected region. You can probably only inject this virus one time. You might be able to do multiple injections, but you probably have one shot at it.
Professor Greenamyre, my name is Greenamyre, Brian here. I'm a postdoc at Jim Serverhouse Lab at Northwestern, and I really enjoyed your talk. I have two questions for you. The first is, I was wondering, in your AAP experiments, how efficient does the virus have to be in order to give the neuroprotection you were saying? So how much of the cytokine has to be knocked down in order to see that? And I was wondering if you saw any kind of behavioral changes in animals that didn't get the rough done. And my second question had to do with your last data slide. I was wondering what the age of those patients were where you were looking at toxin exposure and Parkinson's and mitochondrial DNA damage. I was wondering, were those older patients or did they span?
Right. So if I remember the first question, it turns out you don't have to knock down alpha-synuclein too much. It looks like we got about 30 to 40% of knockdown. And it turns out alpha-synuclein is an extremely long-lived protein. Has a turnover of about a month. And in the time frame that we did these experiments, the protein levels in the nigral neurons were down about 30, probably closer to 40%. That in itself, in animals that didn't get rotenone, was not associated with any behavioral changes. And there was no evidence of any toxicity of the virus. So it didn't damage it. And there's a report, or at least maybe a couple of reports, that this approach might be toxic. I think we can talk about the reasons for that, but I don't think it is. In terms of the other data, the second to last slide showed people with different kinds of exposures and with or without Parkinson's disease. All of the Parkinson's patients had the DNA damage, whether or not they got the exposures, but there was the one group who had the exposure but did not yet have Parkinson's disease. In the last slide, it was just a cross-sectional view of Parkinson's patients, typical ages of onset, various durations, so it's completely cross-sectional at this point.
They known about Parkinson's disease since about 1755, when all of the poisons, or a lot of them, didn't exist. Could it be a nutritional deficiency that's causing it, or what could be causing it? I know the brain reacts to something, but what is the basic cause?
Well, that's the billion-dollar question. We don't know. There are several themes that run in Parkinson's disease causation. One of them is that the cellular power plants sort of poop out with age. The mitochondria that I sort of focused on in my talk, we know that they become less efficient with age. They produce less energy and more pollution in the form of free radicals. The second theme that runs through Parkinson's disease is that the normal sort of garbage disposal systems in the cell to get rid of damaged proteins or things that kind of gum up the system, those also aren't functioning well. So you end up with all this garbage accumulating in the cells and not getting rid of it properly. Why this happens in any one individual, I think, is a combination of your genetic makeup. You have lots of genes that either increase or decrease your risk in small increments, and so you have a very complex genetic background that's going to alter your ultimate risk of developing the disease, and all of that is superimposed on everything that you've been exposed to in the course of your life, in what you eat and drink and breathe, and so on. And there are toxins in the environment, both natural and man-made, and our susceptibility to them. Our individual susceptibility varies from person to person based on your genetic makeup. So I think it's very complex. So we have a little bit of a handle on some of the genetics and a little bit of a handle on the environmental exposures. But the vast majority of people in the middle, we can't tell any individual what has caused the disease.
Thank you, Dr. Greenamyre. We'll take questions. You can put them on your sheets of paper later and we'll answer them.